Hello, greetings to everyone. Welcome to VTU eShikshana program. We are continuing with the course Building Services 3, Air Conditioning Modules in this particular session. 18 ARC 63 for BIARC 6 semester session, April to August 2021. I, Dr. Dakshayani R. Patil, Associate Professor, BMS College of Architecture, Bull Temple Road, welcome you all for this particular continuation in the module 1 of the Building Services 3. Right, so module 1, Mechanical Ventilation and Air Conditioning, in introduction. This is what we are doing in the past few lectures and continuing here with. So module 1, section number 2, deals with refrigeration process and cycle. And briefly speaking, the content, we have already started this particular section in the last class. We saw what is the definition of refrigeration, what are the applications of refrigeration, the fluid refrigerant and its importance, the ideal characteristics of refrigerant to be used in a refrigeration process, right? So now we are continuing ahead with the process understanding, the types of cycles, heat pump and cooling towers briefly. We also saw what is the unit of refrigeration, if you all can recollect and tell me now, right? Ton of refrigeration. So let us commence with the refrigeration cycle as the discourse for this particular class. Now let us very slowly understand the definition here. Refrigeration cycle comprises of a fluid called as refrigerant. This refrigerant is the heat exchange medium in the cycle. Heat exchange from one point to another point. So let us read it now. The refrigerant starts at some initial state or condition, passes through a series of processes in a definite sequence, changing from one state to another, and returns to the initial state to begin the cycle over again and again. So it's a cycle, has a start point where you come back, end, and again begin from the start point. And the component that is flowing across the cycle is the fluid called as refrigerant. Okay, so it will start at point A. It is in some state, say liquid or vapor. Then it passes through a series of chemical processes, physical processes, like evaporation, condensation, compression. So there is a sequence in which it flows through the system to create that cycle of events happening. And while it passes from point A to B to C to D, say primarily say four stages, it happens to change its state, liquid to vapor, vapor to liquid. Now that is a very important characteristic of this fluid, which is called as a refrigerant, because it is not like it takes hours together or days together to change from one state to another. No, it is quite rapid, and that's a very interesting integral property of the refrigerant. So it begins at a point A, passes through point B, C, D, comes back to A, and in that quick cycle it is going to change its state from one to another. Okay, so there is a sequence of processes that is happening in a systematic sequential manner. So that comprises the refrigeration cycle. And broadly speaking, there are two types of refrigeration cycle: vapor compression refrigeration and vapor absorption refrigeration. Short form, we'll also call across the session now VCR or VAR. So these are the two types of refrigeration cycles available for different types of refrigeration systems. The application we have seen in the last session, we apply the application of refrigeration in domestic refrigeration, that is our most humble fridge, freezer that we have at our home grounds. Then there is commercial refrigeration, large scale, like in supermarkets, cold storage areas. Then we have industrial refrigeration. Then we have comfort air conditioning system, also based on refrigeration, that is creating a comfortable indoor environment for people. We have industrial air conditioning, which will take care of processes of manufacturing, chemicals, breweries, etc. Then there is transportation refrigeration for refrigerating automobiles or marine transportation or air to carry the goods that you manufactured in the industry from its point of generation to the point of market or destination. Alright, so coming back, vapor compression refrigeration and vapor absorption refrigeration. Two types of cycles which we will see in detail ahead. So now let us understand what is a refrigeration cycle and the processes involved. A simple basic refrigeration cycle is most time always made up of four fundamental processes, and they're called as expansion, vaporization, compression and condensation. The refrigerant, the fluid that we spoke about earlier, is going to pass through the various components or parts of the refrigeration cycle, undergoing these processes in a sequential manner. So as it expands, it turns to gas, it vaporizes, compresses back to liquid and condenses. So it's a cyclic process, and these four processes follow one after the other in a given sequence throughout the process of refrigeration. So we will begin with the type one, that is vapor compression refrigeration cycle, VCR cycle. Now this was invented almost two centuries back, around 1800s. Mr. Oliver Evans, he was an American inventor. He described a closed vapor compression refrigeration cycle as for producing ice. So that was the intent at that given point of time. So ice, you need to condense water, bring down the temperature, and that was the intent for the invention or for the introduction of vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Natural gas plants, petroleum refineries, petrochemical plants, and most of the food and beverage processes are some of the industrial plants where VCR was used and is still in use, with extended usage such as air conditioning of homes, automobiles, etc. The simplest explanation of a vapor compression refrigeration cycle may be a heat engine. A heat engine, but working in a reverse order, technically referred to as the reverse Carnot engine. So what does this imply? It implies that the transfer of heat is happening or should happen from a cold reservoir to a hot one, unlike in the heat engine. So it is the reverse of heat engine. That's why transfer of heat from a cold reservoir to a hot one. Now, as per the second law of thermodynamics, heat energy does not spontaneously transfer from a cold to a hot reservoir. Unlikely. No, it is not going to happen that way. So, in order to have the heat transfer in that direction, what direction? Not from hot to cold, as a system is naturally inclined to in a heat system, but the other way, reverse. Hence, it is necessary to do work on the system. And that is a principle on which a refrigeration cycle will be based upon. Now, the VCR cycle is most often very widely used in air conditioning, various scales of buildings and automobiles as well. Automobiles, marine refrigeration, transportation modes, air, airways, etc. The applications are fairly easy. It is easy to construct a cooling device employing this method, and it is cost effective as well. So this has made it quite a well adapted or widely adapted refrigeration system. Now, in relation to the four processes that we saw earlier, expansion, condensation, etc., we will have four main components of a VCR cycle. What are they? Now we are going actually talking about the parts, the components of a VCR cycle in compliance with the processes that we saw. So evaporator, compressor, condenser, and throttling device. So four very important components have to be remembered by all of us: evaporator, compressor, condenser, and throttling device. Throttling device also is called as refrigerant flow control. And the nomenclature gives away what it must be doing, right? It will control the amount of refrigerant flowing from one part to another. In addition to these primary components, there are other ancillary parts like receiver tank, suction line, liquid line, discharge line, various valves, controls, ducts, etc. So, to enable the entire cycle or process of refrigeration, we have four fundamental processes and four components or parts which will enable the four processes. The four components are evaporator, compressor, condenser, and throttling device. So, with these four, additionally, to enable the entire cycle or process, we have other ancillary components. Now, I have tried to draw a very easy schematic diagram of the refrigeration cycle and labeled it so it becomes easy for us to understand. Okay, but at one glance may not be possible. So let us go step by step. Now, I spoke about four parts. So I will call it one evaporator. I hope you can see my cursor. One evaporator. Okay. Two suction line. Three compressor. Four discharge line. Five condenser. Six receiver tank. Seven liquid line. 8 throttling device. So 8 components, of which we spoke about 4 important ones. So I will point at them now. Evaporator, this entire coil, compressor here, condenser, which is again a coil, and throttling device. 1, 3, 5, 8 numbers here. These were the four. I'm going back to the previous slide. four main components: evaporator, compressor, condenser, throttling device, and the add-ons. So you have the evaporator, you have the compressor, you have the condenser, and the throttling device. Four components, okay? And these are supported with other parts like the suction line, discharge line, liquid line, receiver tank. Is it clear? Please take time to point out the four main components: evaporator, compressor, condenser, throttling device, and see the location. First you get the throttling device. It's a cyclic anyways, but I'll just begin for our easy understanding. Followed by evaporator. Evaporator is followed by compressor, compressor by condenser, and then we come back to the throttling device. So in between we have suction line, discharge line, receiver tank, liquid line. Okay, then if you see between these parts, you have a black line with an arrow, correct? So that is the pipe in which our refrigerant fluid is flowing, and the arrow tells us the direction of the fluid or the refrigerant, and it's a cycle, correct? So it begins, it connects all the components and goes in a cyclic way in a anti-clockwise direction in this particular diagram. Okay, if you draw it the other way, it could be clockwise also. But to remember the sequence of the components, the sequence of the components and the lines that are connecting them, through which the refrigerant is flowing in that particular direction. Okay, so we will draw a diagram. We will mark the components. Okay, we will mark the line of the path of the refrigerant, the direction of the refrigerant connecting across all of them. So is that much clear as of now? Okay, I take it yes. So you have drawn the components, you know the path of the refrigerant and the direction, and you have labeled the parts. Okay, then what else do you see in this diagram? I have written something called as A, B, C, D. Okay, now A, B, C, D, I am referring to the stage of the cycle. Okay, stage of the cycle and the state of the refrigerant. So you have to begin somewhere, right? If it's a cycle, there has to be some point of beginning. So you can choose what point it is. In this discourse, I am choosing the point just before throttling device as A, okay? As it enters evaporator as B, when it leaves evaporator as C, when it leaves compressor as D, and then it comes back to A again. Okay, and in bracket I have written the state and temperature pressure of the refrigerant. That's the way to read this entire diagram. Okay, I hope it is clear. So this is a schematic sketch of a refrigeration cycle, vapor compression refrigeration cycle. So first thing you do is you will label the parts, the main ones being evaporator, compressor, condenser, throttling device, the four. They are supported with suction line, discharge line, receiver tank, liquid line. So anything that pink written ones are the components in the cycle. They are all connected by this black line which is going in the anticlockwise manner with the arrow shown. That is the refrigerant flow path. There are pipes through which the refrigerant is flowing. So much so good. After that, we have marked four stages in the cycle A, B, C, D, right? So that we are referring to the stage of the refrigerant as it flows across the system. So what do we see now? Now I think I'll move to the next slide so I can explain A, B, C, D. Now you are aware we are talking of these stages. We will go step by step between A, B, B, C, C, D, D, A. Is that all right? At this point I also want to tell you can either draw the schematic cycle in this manner or you can use any other mode that is available in various sources. So this is a diagram in Edward Peter's book, page number 333. Okay, so what do you see here? Let me just guide you through. Evaporator, which is shown like that. Opposite to evaporator will always be the condenser and both are coils. In between the two, you will have the compressor and see the fluid going from evaporator anticlockwise. Then you have the flow control device, which is also called as throttling device or evaporator or the refrigerant control device. Okay, so same thing, same explanation, but you can use various modes of schematically representing it. And they also have shown 1, 2, 3, 4. You have to start at some point. So 1, 2, 3, 4 stages are shown. Then the fluid conditions are written here. At what degree it is and what state it is. Correct? So that is how we will draw as suitable to us. But the basic understanding is on how the process conducts yourself and how the cycle moves ahead. So drawing the schematic of the refrigeration cycle is left to you as long as you explain it legibly and each stage defined well. So let us begin with stage A. So you see the stage A here, my pointer scene. Okay, so we are beginning at that point as an initial state, and we saw that it's a thermodynamic cycle. So there is a series of events that happens in a cyclic manner. So stage A essentially will be called as throttling and expansion process. Okay, so at point A, this one, the refrigerant is in liquid state and at high pressure and temperature. So refrigerant at stage A is as a liquid and high temperature, high pressure. What happens ahead? The refrigerant flows through the throttling device, this one. Throttling valve or flow control device or throttling valve, these are synonyms. You can use any one of them, and it when it passes through that, the basic function of this throttling device is to send the right amount of refrigerant from point A into the evaporator. Okay, so it is controlling the amount of refrigerant that can enter the evaporator. So in this process, it expands and reduces pressure. Okay, beautifully. The refrigerant leaves the throttling valve as a liquid vapor mixture, typically in proportions of around 75% to and 25%. So at when it crosses the throttling device, it becomes partly liquid, partly vapor, because of the action that happens in the refrigerant control. The amount of refrigerant entering is controlled. Okay, so it expands, and when you reduce the quantity, what happens? Pressure comes down. So that is what happens. And at B, When it enters the evaporator, it is in a mixed state, liquid plus vapor. So throttling valves play two crucial roles in the vapor compression cycle. Kindly note this. One, it maintains a pressure differential between low and high pressure sides. So high pressure this side, low pressure to the other side. It is maintaining that required pressure differential. Control the right amount of liquid refrigerant entering the evaporator. So it is calibrated to sense and send the calibrated amount of refrigerant into the evaporator. So very nicely it does its work. Consequently, the temperature drops at this stage. Now you can relate to this, the pressure drops. Hence, proportionately, the temperature of the refrigerant has dropped now. That's a point to note, and it is in mixed state, liquid plus vapor. So far, is that clear? So we have done from at stage A, called as throttling and expansion. It is advisable that you make notes as we proceed ahead, so it becomes imbibed, and then you wouldn't have to by heart it. As long as you know how, on what principle or how it is happening, the differential between pressure, temperature, change in state and the process, it is easy to perceive. So shall I go to the next stage? That is the stage B. That is here. So this is the stage of evaporation. Now, the refrigerant enters the evaporator. Evaporator is the heat exchanger. So this point is very crucial, and I will raise this question as we proceed ahead. So evaporator now has two circuits. One circuit, both parallel circuits. One, the refrigerant is flowing through it. Second, there is a fluid that has to be cooled. Okay, evaporator has this, what we have drawn here, has two circuits, one behind the other, parallel. You can see one here. One set of pipes, the refrigerant is flowing. In the other, there is a fluid, and that fluid could be water or air. So this air or water usage continues now till we complete this entire understanding of refrigeration and AC. Please remember, whenever asked, what is the fluid that you have used to cool? It is either air or water. The fluid is at a higher temperature than the refrigerant. If you remember, from point A to point B, the refrigerant experienced a drop in its pressure, consequently drop in its temperature, correct? So now the fluid which is running in the second circuit of the evaporator is at a higher temperature than the refrigerant. Now what is the principle of heat? It moves from high to low. So which is at high temperature? Fluid. Which is at lower temperature? Refrigerant. So the heat transfers from the fluid to the refrigerant. So when the refrigerant gets the heat, boils. Basic property, when you boil water, it boils, milk, it just boils up. So it will leave the evaporator as vapor. When you boil, you must have seen there is smoke, vapor coming out. So the refrigerant now leaves the evaporator as a vapor. So if you see at C, I have written VAP, that's vapor, at low temperature, low pressure. So at A, it was high temperature, high pressure. How easily and quickly it became low temperature, low pressure. Hope that is clear. So we have seen stages A and B, two components, throttling device, evaporator seen, and evaporation process has happened. Next, stage C, this one, the process of compression is going to be witnessed here. Now, the refrigerant leaves the evaporator at low temperature and low pressure, and it is in a gas state. To continue the refrigerating effect, it must be brought back to A. The state at A was liquid, correct? It has become vapor now. Now to complete the cycle, it can't remain vapor. Then there is no process happening whatsoever. So you have to bring it back to liquid state. For that, what do we do? Now, we will let it enter the compressor. It will not enter by default. There is a suction line here which creates a suction power, and it enters the compressor. Now, compressor, what happens? The process of compression takes place. When you compress something, it raises the temperature and the refrigerant pressure. Imagine a bottle which has a piston in it. And put lot of thermocol balls or something which are lightweight. When you pump in the piston, it gets stacked there. So that is increasing the pressure. When you increase pressure, temperature also increases. So from C, the vapor state, low temperature, low pressure, it is entering the compressor, compression takes place. So that low temperature, low pressure vapor has to become high pressure, high temperature now. Slowly we are getting back to A. Since this process requires work for the compression, like the piston, an electric motor is used. Compressors themselves can be scroll type, screw type, centrifugal type, or reciprocating type of compressors. The mode or the methodology of compression could be anywhere of these four. You can do a reading on this, or I will be posting the further details on the e-notes. Refrigerant leaves the compressor, okay, and enters the condenser. So you see my cursor from 3, compressor to condenser. The refrigerant is now in a vapor state at high temperature, high pressure. So between that you have the discharge line. These are ancillary supporting players. Now stage D, condensation. So condensation is going to happen once the refrigerant enters the condenser. The refrigerant leaves the compressor at high temperature, high pressure. Okay. Now it cannot remain as gas. It has to be brought back to the liquid state. So the condenser is in fact the heat exchanger. It is changing from vapor high temperature to liquid. It is called as heat exchanger. Again, similar to evaporator, condenser will have two circuits. You can definitely tell me now what are the two circuits. One, the refrigerant flows. Second, the cooling fluid is flowing. Now you will have to tell me what is the fluid we are talking about. Yes. Air or water. Now the heat transfers from the refrigerant to the fluid. Okay, it was the reverse in evaporator if you recollect. Now the refrigerant condenses back to liquid. This cycle continues and repeats. Wonderfully it goes back to state A. Okay, so condenser has two circuits, refrigerant and the cooling fluid, correct? So heat transfers from the refrigerant. Now refrigerant is very high temperature at this state. It has to cool down, right? So it will come back, and it's in vapor state basically. So it has to come back to the liquid state. So it condenses in the condenser. And once it converts to liquid, suddenly you have to have a container. For that, we use the receiver tank. So in the receiver tank, it drops down as liquid state refrigerant. It is collected there. It's like a bottle to hold it before you send it ahead. So that's why now this refrigerant passes through the liquid line, reaches stage A and comes back to the being a liquid at high temperature pressure, and then the throttling device will control the right amount of refrigerant to flow into the evaporator. So wonderfully and systematically this cycle is going to continue across these components, and in that cyclic manner giving rise to the processes of expansion, compression, condensation. Correct? So this is how a VCR cycle will take place. It is easy when you understand the various parts, the path of the refrigerant, the state of the refrigerant, and how the processes contribute to changing the temperature pressure of the refrigerant. And like I said, you can choose your own way of drawing the diagram as long as it conveys the correct process, and you will have to explain it ideally as a stage wise. Even then, it is left to you as long as you express the process in the right manner. So I think this class we will end here. Next, we will continue with vapor absorption refrigeration cycle. All right, see you. Till then, thank you.